Hey there, it's Alina, your friendly nuclear physicist, and today we're going to be reacting to a video by Kurzgesagt. I'm not sure I'm pronouncing this correctly, the name is up there. This is a video suggested by you guys. It has 7.5 million views, and we need to get into it and see if the information that is presented there is accurate or not. Let's get into it.
Do we need nuclear energy to stop climate change?
It's a big question.
More and more voices from science, environmental activists, and the press have been saying so in recent years. But this comes as a shock to those who are fighting against nuclear energy and the problems that come with it.
Again, the misinformation about the nuclear energy and the bad, let's say, part of power plant being presented as being the steam turbine. No, not the steam turbine, the cooling tower. I guess he's using the picture because everybody's using the picture. But if you want to, let's say, debunk things about nuclear energy, you would not want to use this picture.
So who's right? Well, it's complicated. To slow rapid climate change, the world needs to reduce greenhouse gas emissions to net zero. In 2018, three-quarters of global emissions were released through energy production, namely by burning fossil fuels. Energy is a broad term that describes all sorts of stuff, from moving things and people around, to putting things big and small together, or heating our homes. Currently, 84% of the world's primary energy comes from fossil fuels.
That's a lot.
33% from oil, 27% from coal, and 24% from gas. Around 10% of the global oil supply is just used to burn in boilers to make our homes cozy and warm. Only about 16% of global energy is from low emission sources, almost 7% from hydroelectric, 5% from solar, wind, bioenergy, wave, tidal, and geothermal combined, and about 4% from nuclear.
So these statistics are always very interesting to, let's say, find out and learn about, but it's important to have the context, right? So when the video is referring to 4% of the energy being produced by nuclear, that means that 4% of the world's energy production comes from nuclear. Whereas every country, of course, has a bigger or smaller percentage depending on if they do use nuclear or not and how many nuclear power plants are in operation in that country. For example, a country like Greece has non-nuclear, so 0% of their energy is produced by nuclear, whereas France has a lot of power plants, 70% of their energy production comes from nuclear power plants. But yes, when you take it as an average throughout the whole world, and there's many countries that don't use nuclear power plants and nuclear energy for energy production, then that number goes down to 4%.
So we pretty much rely on coal, oil, and gas to keep our civilization going, which means it's actually very hard to transition away from them. To have a chance of escaping fossil fuels without throwing humanity back into the Stone Age, one of the most impactful things we can do is to electrify as many sectors as possible. Electricity is the stuff that appears like magic when you plug something into a socket so you can watch YouTube. Every industry that can switch from burning fossil fuels to electricity needs to do so, from electric cars to electric heaters. Why do we need to bet so hard on electricity? Because we can produce electricity with low emission technologies like solar, wind, or nuclear. So electricity is a real lever for a radical transition. But there are a few problems making this transition really hard. First of all, in most places in the world, electricity is still generated mostly by burning fossil fuels. And not only that, in the last 20 years, the world's electricity usage increased 73% in absolute terms.
So of course, the electricity demand is increasing, it's an ever-growing number, and it will only be increasing in the future with the way that technology is advancing. So yes, it is a real problem, it is a real issue that needs to be addressed, and the numbers that he gave and the video gives about the, let's say, electricity production and the different forms of energy that produce electricity are also not that promising at the moment. We saw that 10% of it is only produced from nuclear, and the majority of it is still produced by fossil fuels, and something that needs to change. It's not, of course, the majority of the problems come down to environmental issues and the CO2 let's say emissions that we have to decrease, but at the same time, you can think of a practical issue, the fact that fossil fuels will finish eventually. They are not a renewable source of energy. They are not a source of energy that grows again, it is pretty much as we have on Earth. So as long as we have it, it's okay. When it finishes, it's just done.
Renewables at record speed. At the same time, the amount of fossil fuel we're burning for electricity still keeps rising year by year. Renewables have so far not been able to catch up with the demand for new electricity, and so despite our progress, emissions from electricity are still rising worldwide. The other alternative to fossil fuels is nuclear, and even though it's not renewable, its greenhouse gas emissions are tiny compared to burning stuff.
So that is actually a very key, let's say, point. So nuclear energy cannot be called necessarily renewable because the product that is used to produce energy, which is uranium, it is uranium that it's in the form of an ore that comes from the underground and the underwater supplies that exist on Earth, meaning that it is a mineral that potentially will be extinct and will be finished. But at the same time, the amount of energy that can be produced with the available uranium we have and the new power plant designs and new reactor designs that can utilize the most amount of uranium that is now out there that is not, let's say, feasible to be utilized for energy production, extends the use of nuclear energy to hundreds of thousands of years. Therefore, in that case, even though nuclear cannot really be called renewable, it can be called sustainable. And adding to that, the fact that it's CO2 emission free while the nuclear power is produced is of course a very big plus to incorporate it in the energy mix of the future.
But in the last 20 years, nuclear has basically stagnated. Countries like China, India, and South Korea built new reactors, while Germany and Japan have been actively taking their nuclear plants offline. Which seems a bit weird if we look at the countries with the most low-carbon electricity in the world that get most of their juice mainly from two sources, nuclear or hydropower.
Mm-hmm. That is actually the case. Countries that have the lowest CO2 emissions are countries who use a combination of hydro and nuclear energy production.
Take France and Sweden. In France, only around 10% comes from fossil fuels, while 67% comes from nuclear and 23% from renewables, primarily hydro. In Sweden, almost 30% comes from nuclear power and about 45% from hydro. So we know that nuclear energy can work at scale. On the technical side, because of the lack of investment and innovation in the last few decades, the majority of the world's nuclear reactors are pretty old technology that's very costly to replace. In most Western countries, building nuclear reactors has become very expensive for a variety of reasons, like a loss of know-how in constructing them, policy changes, and increased regulatory constraints, so it can take a decade or longer just to finish a power plant.
Yeah, that is unfortunately the sad truth and reality out there. Nuclear has been brought down for a lot of reasons over the past years, political reasons, accidents that have happened over the years, and it has become, let's say, very hard for nuclear power plants or people who do want to build nuclear power plants to actually do so. The procedures are much more complicated. It's much harder to do anything. And this is not referred to the fact that the safety is actually strengthened, because this is a good thing and power plants and power plant designers do respond to this very well. The safety of the reactors that are to be built in the, let's say, new generation are much safer, are much more reliable. They have no such problems like the previous reactors have faced. However, in order to build them, in order to invest a big chunk of capital to them, it's a whole another issue which brings a lot of problems compared to how easily renewable energies are funded to be built, in which case one could question their efficiency for the amount of money you pay to actually put them in a country.
In contrast, countries like South Korea, China, India, and Russia are able to build new nuclear reactors comparatively quickly and at a competitive cost. Still, generally in the West, the current generation of nuclear power plants are more expensive to build and maintain than most fossil fuel alternatives. There are also the concerns about nuclear waste and the fear of accidents, but we cover those in other videos in more detail. We have designs for nuclear reactors that solve many of their problems, namely small reactors that take less time and money to get started.
Exactly.
There are also next-generation technologies that can already turn radioactive waste into new fuel, but so far these have not been deployed at a scale where they can have a significant impact on the nuclear sector. Considering these uncertainties, some argue that nuclear power is a dangerous relic of the past and that we should just let it go and focus on renewables. But while renewables undoubtedly are the future of electricity, they still have their own huge challenges to overcome before they can take over the vast majority of the electricity grid.
Yeah, so I'm really glad this is actually mentioned in the video. It is indeed the case that most of the nuclear engineers out there do understand that renewables are and they are to be the future. However, in the moment, in the present moment, how renewables are constructed, the efficiency that they have, and what they can generate for a country is very much limited to rely solely on renewables to generate power and electricity and energy for a country's, to meet a country's needs. Therefore, that's why we're always discussing about an energy mix. So yes, the renewables are in the forefront of everything, but at the same time, they do need a backup for the times that simply the wind is not blowing or the sun is not shining. So practical issues like that renewables are facing, nuclear is not. So in that case, that is the, let's say, incentive, and that is the motive of people working in the nuclear industry and trying to promote it and add it to the energy mix necessary to reduce carbon dioxide, but at the same time, meet the energy demands of the future and the present.
The main problem is reliability and consistency.
Yes.
It's not always windy and the sun doesn't always shine,
precisely,
especially in the mornings and evenings when humans need the most electricity. The variations between seasons don't make this issue easier. To make renewables reliable and not risk blackouts, we need massive storage capacities where we can save energy collected when the sun or wind are at their peak and release it later when we actually need it. Until this is possible, other sources of electricity need to provide a controllable load that creates the reliability of supply that our civilization needs to run properly. Eventually, we will be able to do this with renewables, but we need a lot of batteries or storage power plants. Right now, we simply don't have the tech and the capacities to make this transition fast enough to replace fossil fuels. But even if we could, there's another aspect we have to take into account. We're not just trying to kick fossil fuels out of electricity, we're trying to replace energy with electricity. If we're going to electrify sectors that currently use fossil fuels, like cars or heating, we will need significantly more electricity than we're currently using everywhere around.
That is also an aspect that people might necessarily not think about immediately, in a sense that it's actually very accurate what is mentioned in the video. If you think about the fact that we want to turn all cars electric, and that would be, of course, much better for the environment. There will be no fumes emitted by the gas-powered cars like we currently have. However, if you think about all cars that are currently used in the world turn electric, meaning that these people drive in their houses and at the end of the week they need to charge their cars. So you can understand the electricity demand that that will bring up to the world in general, and especially coming also adding up to the fact that electricity demand is only going to be increasing in the future from other aspects of our lives, other machinery that we use, even everyday appliances that we use. So in that case, it is not just about seeing how the demand looks like right now and trying to figure out a replacement for that. It is seeing how the demand looks like right now, trying to estimate how the demand looks like when everything will, or at least everything possible, will turn into like electricity and something that you can plug in, and try to meet that demand
around the world. And if the electricity needs of the world population continue to grow as they have over the last 20 years, we'll need even more.
Yes.
It all comes down to one thing. No energy source is perfect. All have their own unique problems. Both renewables and nuclear energy require time, investment, and technological innovation. On their own, neither is ready to remove fossil fuels from our electricity grid, although activists on both sides claim that they are. In the end, the question is how we want to deal with all these challenges.
Yeah, so this is a very big question that the video is posing, and it's actually very accurate, that of course you have activists and people that are, let's say, supporting one energy over the other in a very strong manner, that have opinions that are not always accurate, that have opinions that this is the kind of energy that can save the world, that can produce everything we need, that can solve all of our problems. Well, not quite. As with pretty much everything else in life, every choice you make has a positive and negative effect on the outcome that you're going to get. So in this case, we don't use fossil fuel, even though we did for many years, because it produces emissions and CO2 gas that is harmful for the environment. We don't use renewables because even though they're good and they are CO2 free, they are not reliable. The energy production is not sufficient. We don't use necessarily nuclear everywhere because even though the energy production might be massive and is available and, let's say, enough to cover the needs of the whole world and even of the increasing energy demand that the world will have, at the same time, issues as storing nuclear waste or nuclear waste under, let's say, attacks as in terrorism or a plane crash or something like this, are issues that people have to work with and deal. That is to say that nothing is quite perfect, but at the same time, nothing is useless. So the best thing that one can do is to find the best combination that works out for each country or continent or a region or area of countries that benefits them in terms of energy production and employ that kind of combination into this particular area.
Should we give up nuclear immediately and at least temporarily accept higher emissions? Will we try to extend the life of current nuclear reactors and shut them down afterwards while solving the shortcomings of renewables? Or will we invest in new nuclear technology to get new nuclear reactor types that are cheaper and safer? Or will we maybe do both? Opinion part starts here. Considering the risks that climate change poses for the biosphere and humanity, any technology that has a chance of contributing to a solution should be pursued. That's just good risk management and strategy. If preventing rapid climate change as quickly as possible is our goal, it might be a good idea to see nuclear and renewables not as opponents, but as partners. Exactly. We know there's no time to waste, so we should keep all of our low-emission players on the field. As things are, both nuclear and renewables need innovation and investment. But if we don't know yet which technology will be ready how quickly, why not just invest in both and see what happens? And on the topic of current capacities, if we take nuclear energy offline right now, then that missing capacity will be replaced, at least partially, by fossil fuels. Even if new nuclear power plants in the West are expensive, in the long run, it may be cheaper to build them as long as they prevent more fossil fuel capacity being added and paying for the consequences of rapid climate change. So, do we need nuclear energy? Well, it really depends how hard we choose to make things for ourselves. And in a world that's already having a really hard time quitting fossil fuels, why should we make things harder than necessary? Starting the change process.
I agree. Absolutely agree with this opinion in a sense that it's not about being, let's say, very fond of nuclear or very against it. It's about understanding its benefits and how can it can, in the moment, benefit the world and the energy demands, meet the energy demands that we need and work with it while at the same time developing the technology of renewables to be able one day to replace everything with renewable and that being reliable enough and efficient enough for all the energy demand that is necessary. This was actually a very interesting video. I didn't really know what to expect from seeing the title. It is to be expected most of the times that people are very much for renewables, very much against nuclear, and the opinions are a little bit like skewed, let's say, because of that and not quite accurate most of the times, but this video was actually very good. I do recommend it. As a nuclear physicist, this gets my stamp of approval. I like this video, it is accurate, it is representative of the reality, and it does give some points for thought and decision making for the future. Let me know what you thought of this reaction and also let me know of more reaction videos you would like me to make because this was your suggestion, was actually a very good one. It's been Elena, your friendly nuclear physicist, and until next time, see you soon. Until, it was a very good one.